Welcome to Great Lakes HABs, a regional update presented by the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative. My name is Connor Ressler with the Great Lakes Commission. On behalf of the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative, thank you for participating in today's webinar. A few notes for logistics. Please remain muted and with your video turned off for the duration of the webinar. The webinar will be recorded and will be posted to the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative page. That link will be shared in the chat shortly. Finally, please submit any questions for our presenters into the chat. After the presentation, I will moderate a Q&A using your questions from the chat. We will have time at the end of the webinar to answer questions, but you can enter your questions into the chat at any time. A little background, the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative was launched in 2015 by the Great Lakes Commission and the U.S. Geological Survey, Great Lakes Science Center, and is working to establish a common agenda on science and management needs to help the region work together to prevent and manage HABs. The goal of the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative is to improve communication among scientists and between scientists and decision makers on issues related to harmful algal blooms in the Great Lakes. For today's webinar, I will finish my brief logistics intro. Then we will hear from our five presenters before moving into a moderated Q&A. We will start with an update on Lake Superior from Gina La Liberty, and then have Sarah Bartlett present on Lake Michigan. This will be followed on a talk on Lake Huron from Doug Pearsall before an update on Lake Erie from Ruth Breland. Finally, an update from Tony Presta-Giacomo on Lake Ontario. Without further ado, we will have our presentation with Gina La Liberty.
All right, starting to share and going to slideshow to see if I can minimize that. There we go. How does this look?
You're looking good.
All right, great. Well, thanks for joining us today. So much of the work that's occurring on Lake Superior is coordinated through the Lake Superior Partnership Working Group's Algal Bloom and Nutrient Subgroup. The Lake Superior Partnership develops and implements the Lake Superior Lakewide Action and Management Plan, otherwise known as the LAMP, under the Binational Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. So the Algal Bloom and Nutrient Subgroup formed in 2018 for binational coordination on algal bloom issues. It includes Canadian, US, and tribal agencies working with the science community. We have a rapid bloom response team and communication plan for when blooms are reported to one of the agencies around the lake. We have a phone tree and standardized field sampling kits staged in Duluth and several places in Wisconsin to enable team members to respond and collect samples from these very often short-lived blooms. So these are the photos of the 2018 bloom along the Wisconsin shore. So not really what you think of when you're thinking about Lake Superior's water quality. Previous blooms, with the exception of the bloom in 2012, had tended to be very small and short-lived. This 2018 bloom was large and extended from the Twin Ports on the west end of Lake Superior of Duluth and Superior into the Apostle Islands National Lakeshore on the Bayfield Peninsula. In 2021 and 2022, we did not see any major blooms. However, there have been some very small, short-lived blooms in Duluth and Superior. These photos show the September 10, 2021 bloom at the public swimming beach at Barker's Island in Superior, Wisconsin. While the beach monitoring season was over, the city of Superior closed the beach and put out a news release out of caution to protect any people who might decide to swim despite the presence of this scum at the beach. This bloom was extremely short-lived and had dissipated later in the day as wind and waves increased. These past blooms in 2021 and 2022 occurred in the Inner Harbor area, which you see in this region, and near the Superior entry right here. While toxins were detected in these blooms did contain additional species that we don't see in the more typical open water dilichospermum lemurmanii dominated blooms. And we have not detected toxins in previous blooms in the open waters of the lake. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about some of the monitoring and research efforts on Lake Superior that are being undertaken by the algal bloom and nutrient subgroup members. So Ellen Cooney is the Lake Superior Sediment and Monitoring Coordinator for the Wisconsin DNR. She has 15 nearshore HAB sites that you see here on the map. That she visits about every other week in mid-June through September in order to capture nearshore water quality changes throughout the potential bloom growing season. And her sites are near the 5-meter contour. She collected algae ID samples in 2022 from sites 8 right here and 14 right here, with additional single sample from site 10 here. And those results are shown here. These results show different algal groups at the sites over the 6 sampling periods. So this is sampling period 1 through 6 for site 8, the single sampling period for site 10, and sampling periods 1 through 6 for site 14. And you'll see that there are some groups that tend to dominate those. So that's diatoms in pink, green algae in this kind of tan color, and cryptophytes in light green. This teal color was the only time in which cyanobacteria were detected. And that's at site 14 again during the 5th and 6th rounds of sampling this past year. So August 23rd and September 7th. There weren't any visible signs of a bloom, and there weren't any distinct differences in chemistries from this site and other sites. And this particular site is at Cornucopia, Wisconsin, where blooms have occurred in the past. Casey Benish is an ORISE fellow at the US EPA, and she works with Abir Banerjee there. So one of the things she's been researching is differences in fish skin mucosal microbiomes in sites with and without blooms. The mucus microbiome in the skin of yellow perch was investigated in 3 sites that had known to be impacted by blooms versus 3 sites in areas without previously documented blooms. At each site, 5 yellow perch that were about 100 millimeters in length were collected by boat shocking. Fish were swabbed for mucus samples and were later returned to the water. And water samples were also collected for a comparison of the ambient environmental microbes to those found in the fish mucus and for water quality parameters. This past year, Casey was able to sample before and after bloom occurrences at Barker's Island in August and September. Her study will identify potential impacts of algal blooms on fish and shifts in microbial communities within these locations. Her study may also provide information on vulnerabilities of the fish community to future HABs and changes in water quality. So stay tuned for future results from Casey. The USGS's Lake Superior HABs work is focused on improving understanding of nutrient transport and transformation from tributaries to the nearshore, and to connect nutrient, sediment, and cyanobacterial loading to biomass and toxin production in the nearshore. 2021 was USGS's Cooperative Science and Monitoring Initiative year on Lake Superior, but there was no major bloom that occurred during that time. USGS is still in the process of working through the huge amount of data they collected, but Anna Baker was able to provide this update. Their preliminary findings from the Siskiwit River, which is a tributary to Lake Superior near the Apostle Islands, shows the following. First, in this figure on the left, they found a very strong log linear relationship between total phosphorus and suspended sediment, both of which correlate strongly to stream flow. And in this plot on the right, they were looking at phosphorus. We can see that the storm event total phosphorus, which is shown by these blue dots, tend to be up here, so that total phosphorus is mostly comprised of particulate phosphorus. There are very minor fluctuations in dissolved orthophosphate, which is shown by the red dots, and in total dissolved phosphorus, which is shown by the green dots. So both of those are down here, even with those large increases in total phosphorus, again, which is shown in blue. The dissolved phosphorus concentrations, which are again shown in green, tend to hover near this dotted line, which is the average stream bed sediment equilibrium phosphorus concentration. And that's 0.15 milligrams per liter. And USGS researchers measured this experimentally on bed sediments that they collected from the Susquehanna River in 2021. This equilibrium phosphorus concentration is the stream water orthophosphate concentration at which there is minimal uptake or release of dissolved phosphorus from sediments. So this suggests that sediment exerts some abiotic control upon bioavailable phosphorus availability. Northland College is one of the academic research members of the algal bloom and nutrient subgroup. Matt Hudson at Northland has been leading their studies on understanding bloom dynamics. They've been sampling 31 nearshore stations for water chemistry and microbial community analysis, shown by these dots in orange. And they're doing this in conjunction with University of Minnesota Duluth researchers. They're also comparing sediment records at three sites shown by the yellow stars, which you see here, here, and here. So currently one of those sites, Siskiwit Bay right here, experiences bloom activity, but Shawamigan Bay shown here does not. Northland has also been working on lab-based experiments to investigate the risk of blooms in Shawamigan Bay. To mute myself for a minute, I'm going to cough. Excuse me. We also have subgroup academic research partners at the University of Minnesota Duluth. So three recent projects from Bob Stirner's lab are highlighted here. First on the left, we have a map of the watersheds in which they are comparing nutrient loading. The watersheds range from an urbanized Superior Wisconsin streams to others with less developed watersheds. At the upper right here, we have maps of the locations at which land and lake sediments have been assessed for phosphorus bioavailability and equilibrium phosphorus concentrations. So this includes sites from left to right on the Nemadji River, the Brule River, and the Susquehanna River here. And then finally, at lower right, lab members are in the midst of a Sea Grant funded project with collaborators at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and Bowling Green State University to look at nutrient addition bioassays across three Great Lakes. So two of the big questions that we have about these blooms in Lake Superior is whether Dolichospermum is growing only in locations where we see blooms and whether it's new to the lake. So Cody Sheik and his students and collaborators at University of Minnesota Duluth have been investigating some of these questions using genomic methods. They've recovered a 16S ribosomal rRNA gene from the 2018 Dolichospermum bloom, and they have used it as a search target in previously generated data sets. So this map at the upper left shows those results So the Dolichospermum was present throughout the epilimnion in the lake, and the size of those dots, shows the its relative abundance, but those are still pretty low abundances. Student Jake Callahan has been looking at Dolichospermum abundance on the Wisconsin shore from June through September, and the figures at the lower left show his results from 2021. So Dolichospermum abundance is variable throughout the summer, and it tends to be more abundant, as you see here, in late July and late September. But those, again, those abundances are still really low, about 1.5%. So finally, Cody and his collaborators look for Dolichospermum DNA preserved in lake sediment cores, as you see in this figure on the right. DNA was detected at depth in the cores. So here's the surface going down to 40 centimeters of depth in the core. These dots show detection of Dolichospermum DNA in there. And this 10 centimeter depth corresponds to about the year 1881. So we are seeing that DNA even deeper in the cores, down to 40 centimeters or so. So it's likely that blooms or otherwise detectable growth of Dolichospermum has been a natural feature on Lake Superior for hundreds of years. And then finally, if you're on the lake this next summer and you see a bloom, please report it. You can also contact me via the dnrhabs@wisconsin.gov email at the bottom if you have questions or if you want to be connected to one of the researchers whose work I've highlighted. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gina. That was a great presentation. We're next moving on to hear from Sarah Bartlett from Lake, who will be talking about Lake Michigan.
All right, thank you everyone. There we go. Okay, so thank you. I will be giving a presentation on Lake Michigan harmful algal blooms. My name is Sarah Bartlett. I am from Newwater, which is the brand of the Green Bay Metropolitan Sewerage District. And Newwater sits right on the mouth of the Fox River, which feeds into Lower Green Bay. And we have been monitoring water quality in the Lower Green Bay for the last 36 years, just to kind of give a little background. So even though I will be talking about Lake Michigan for the most part, Lake Michigan doesn't experience harmful algal blooms or cyanobacterial blooms. There are at least two known locations that have had cyanobacterial bloom observations. And for the most part though, we generally tend to experience those in Lower Green Bay. And I'll go into a little bit more detail, but I know there have been some accounts of blooms in Grand Traverse or even Little Traverse Bay. But really the focus of this presentation is going to be on just Green Bay, just given the high concentration of and historical concentration of harmful algal blooms. So I wanted to just give a brief overview of some of the current harmful algal bloom monitoring tools that exist for Lake Michigan. This is an image from Siegel, which it's from just this week though. So it's possible that there are some buoys in Lake Michigan that have some pigment sensors that I've missed. I just kind of did a quick little survey of some of the buoys that are out there. But for the most part, the buoys that have some pigment sensors, whether it's chlorophyll or phycocyanin, there's one in Muskegon. And then there's also another buoy, the Atwater buoy in Milwaukee. For the most part, it looked like the majority of the buoys that have pigment sensors are all concentrated in the Green Bay area. So again, I apologize if you have any more information on this, please feel free to put it in the chat to let others know. This was just really a quick survey, but for the mostly all of the buoys that are in the Green Bay area all have pigment sensors. And here's just a little list of the buoys. Some other monitoring tools include the Sea Prism, which is a device that's deployed in Lower Green Bay, and it's to it ground truths some of the satellite algorithms. I'll go into more detail on that in just a moment. And then, as Gina mentioned, the other current project that's going on that I'm aware of is that joint sea grant funded project between Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Ohio to look at algal bloom bioassays. So I won't be going into any more detail about that either. So I wanted to just, since this is kind of a large group, I wanted to kind of orient everyone to some of the, what kind of impacts Green Bay water quality. And basically you can break up Green Bay into three very non-scientific geographical locations. You've got the upper Green Bay, the mid bay, and then the lower bay. Already you can see from this MODIS image that there are some stark differences between the lower bay, which has that nice little bloom going on, and then the upper bay. The upper Green Bay does mix with Lake Michigan proper, and it a lot of that cold water mixes in. It helps kind of keep the, it's just that water then tends to be very oligotrophic or even mesotrophic. And so it's not really as habitable of an environment for a cyanobacterial bloom to occur just given the growing season. Whereas when you have the lower Green Bay, it is fed by the Fox River Lake Winnebago system, which flows north, empties into Lower Green Bay, Green Bay is the world's largest freshwater estuary. So it does a fantastic job harboring those nutrients. It's very shallow. The nutrients then tend to kind of stay really entrained in the lower Green Bay, and they don't really move much further into the Mid Bay. So the conditions in lower Green Bay are very nutrient-rich, eutrophic and hyper-eutrophic conditions. This is an image right at the mouth of the Fox River. There's lots of things that flow into the river and then just kind of settle out, given it's an industrial area, its watershed is very agricultural. So it has the ability, given that it's so shallow, it gets warm really quickly there. And then again, the nutrients are, they really just settle out. And it provides just a great location for cyanobacterial blooms to grow and proliferate. It's not called Green Bay for any reason. It's got a long historical record of having, these green blooms, which we can assume now, some of the earlier records, they probably were all related to cyanobacterial blooms. And this is one of the areas where we do know that these blooms can produce cyanobacterial toxins. However, it wasn't until 2014 that really kind of this first spatial study was completed looking at cyanobacterial toxins in Green Bay. We looked for not just your microcystins, we also looked for some other groups of cyanotoxins. And what we found here, just looking, these are just two quick figures from some of the work that we did. There were definitely instances, just looking at some grab samples within the lower to Mid Bay. This right here, just for a point of reference, is Little Sturgeon Bay. We do see that from surface samples, we definitely were able to measure microcystins over 4 micrograms per liter. And then the following year, we definitely can measure microcystins in the Fox River, which this work has definitely grown. And we've been able to kind of expand this spatial study. And we know that Green Bay has experienced cyanobacterial toxins every year since this study was first reported. So going into the Green Bay buoys, this is just, I couldn't zoom in too far, but I wanted to try and give as much of an overview as possible. As I mentioned, all of these buoys, I think with the exception of the one right in the middle, they all have pigment sensors on them. I don't have any data to report from this year. However, if you go to seagull.gloss.org, you can go ahead and look at these buoys. Actually, these two are still out in the water, but they're one of them. I think the Sturgeon Bay buoy is not collecting data anymore, so they're still out there. At least I think the Nicolet one is, and you can feel free to kind of peruse these data on your own if you wanted to kind of see what the conditions were like. Anecdotally, I'll say that it wasn't as green of a year as it historically has been. We did experience blooms, but it was not necessarily kind of a record year for harmful algal blooms in Green Bay. So I just wanted to put that resource out there for people if they were interested. Another project that's been ongoing, as I mentioned a couple slides ago, is this sea prism. We are actually at a navigational aid marker. When I say we, I mean this is a collaboration between NewWater and then NASA. This is NASA's equipment, and then we serve as the field managers for keeping the equipment deployed and maintained. This project started several years ago, and the goal of the project is it's this gold device right here, and what it does is it actually works to measure the water color and kind of the turbidity of the water. So what it will do is it will, every 15 minutes, it does a little bit of calibration, but it essentially will turn around and it will look at the water and it'll be like, okay, this is what I think green is. And then it will flip up and it will transmit to a satellite, providing some ground truthing, like, okay, but the satellite, what color you're seeing right now, it is green. So therefore, the NASA is able to really strongly tweak the algorithms that they use for satellite detections of blooms in some of these water bodies that might be more closer to some shoreline. That's Green Bay is a great example for a body of water that kind of has some shoreline that's decently close to it with regards to using satellites for monitoring for blooms. The Sea Prism is part of a larger AeroNet program. So Green Bay is one of three freshwater bodies that was selected to participate in the deployment, given the history that we have had with harmful algal blooms or cyanobacterial blooms. It also was selected because of NewWater's aquatic monitoring program. So NewWater, as I mentioned, has been monitoring these waters since 1986. We not only have several buoys in the water, but we also measure for chlorophyll and phycocyanin. So we're able to ground truth the Sea Prism, which ground truths the satellites. So it's really just a really nice way to, you know, use a bunch of different research tools and kind of help fine tune the satellites for, you know, being used as a tool. I'll very quickly say that following the cyanotoxin spatial analysis from 2014 to 2015, a project began which was a collaboration amongst many different organizations, the Wisconsin DNR, UW-Milwaukee, UW-Green Bay, and it was a five-year project that focused on some several sites in Lower Green Bay that we essentially wanted to ask, are cyanotoxins being measured in recreational areas? And if so, what are the concentrations of these cyanotoxins? And when are we kind of measuring when are we measuring some of the toxins during like the growing season, the recreational season? So just really quick, here's just one figure looking at toxins at a Southern Green Bay site. These are just some preliminary results from that five-year study. And using the 8 micrograms per liter as our recreational water standard, you can see that there were several instances throughout this five-year program where we did measure microcystins that were well over that recreational guideline. At this point, there are really no, there's not an actual swimming beach in the lower Green Bay area, but there is a lot of recreation that does occur. And so this information was really helpful to us because it allows us to kind of look at the duration of a growing season and cyanotoxins were not being measured. And so this really provides a really nice background that yes, we do have instances where we are exceeding this guideline. This is a good indicator that more work and more monitoring is needed in Green Bay. Finally, I wanna end with NewWater's aquatic monitoring program. We have about 20 sites in Lower Green Bay that we have been measuring since 1986. And as I said, we are looking at a suite of different water quality parameters, including total phosphorus, total suspended solids, and chlorophyll. So I want to apologize. I don't have anything current from 2022 yet, but I did want to show some of the historical figures. This is looking at total phosphorus just for the last couple of decades. And if you wanted to focus on, there's been a lot of efforts to try and reduce the phosphorus and the runoff that's occurring into Lower Green Bay. And so if you look at some of these data points right here, you've got the five-year average from the first 5 years of the monitoring program kind of sitting around 0.15 milligrams per liter of total phosphorus. This is the Fox River, so it's going to be definitely we have a strong trophic gradient in Green Bay. And as you move away from the Fox River, you get further away, your water quality tends to improve. And so the most recent five-year average that I have is from 2016 to 2021. You can see that we have definitely had a strong decrease in the amount of total phosphorus concentrations that have been measured. We measure a typical growing season. And then we have, we were able to measure decreases in total phosphorus for all of the zones. This is just a really rough average for the zones though, but it did allow us to see that this water quality standard line, we are getting closer to meeting it for the Fox River. And how does that then translate into total chlorophyll? Again, we're not trying to make a correlation here, but just quickly, we can see that looking at the annual average of chlorophyll, we have made some improvements with the occurrence of chlorophyll, which we would use as our proxy for cyanobacteria in this area. And we are seeing some decreases in chlorophyll, although I do want to urge caution that we know how dynamic blooms can be, and it's possible that we are just, missing some of the surface blooms that are occurring when we go out and we collect these samples. However, it is still really promising that we are seeing decreases, although chlorophyll and phosphorus, they're still going to be measured in the lower bay on the scales that are very much eutrophic and hypereutrophic. So that is just kind of an overview of some of the most recent research. And definitely, I would say that it's great to see some changes and some improvements, but we do have a long way to go. So with that, I will thank you and I'll stop sharing.
Thank you so much, Sarah. That was a great presentation. I want to remind you all that you can put your questions into the chat and we will get to a moderated Q&A after all the presentations. Up next, we will hear from Doug Pearsall, who will give us a unique perspective on Lake Huron.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. Let me know. It looks like that's coming through. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Doug Pearsall of the Nature Conservancy in Michigan, and I'll be giving an update on Lake Huron. In contrast to most of the other talks today, my talk is focused on watershed actions and monitoring within Saginaw Bay and its tributaries, rather than on the details of harmful algal blooms in Lake Huron. So before I begin, I do want to thank the HABs Collaborative for the opportunity to provide a glimpse into how the Nature Conservancy and partners are collaborating to address nutrient and sediment issues, including harmful algal blooms in Saginaw Bay. I also want to acknowledge that people have been part of the Lake Huron Basin for many thousands of years, and that the Saginaw Bay watershed lies within the traditional home area of the Anishinaabeg people. And I pay respect to the indigenous peoples who are the past, current and future stewards of these lands and waters, especially our partners in the Saginaw Chippewa tribe. And today, I'm going to provide an overview of Saginaw Bay, why it's important and some of the challenges it faces, and then describe how we are addressing those challenges, both through our soil health and nutrient strategies and through the Saginaw Bay Monitoring Consortium. So for those of you who aren't familiar, Saginaw Bay is the largest watershed in Michigan and the primary source of nutrients to Lake Huron. And I should point out that the main body of Lake Huron is actually oligotrophic, and managing the offshore fishery while addressing nutrient issues in Saginaw Bay is a wicked problem that people are beginning to think about. The watershed is roughly 50% agricultural with a high diversity of crops, and is a key component of the ag economy in Michigan while serving as home to more than 1.4 million people. And like Lake Erie, Saginaw Bay is very productive, and a substantial proportion of Lake Huron's fish are also spawned and reared in the bay. And the bay and its coastal areas provide globally important stopover habitat to birds migrating on the Mississippi Flyway.
Hi, Doug. I just want to let you know, we are seeing just your video and not your slides.
Well, I'm glad you told me that. Hold on one moment. I apologize for that.
All right, now we're looking good. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm sorry I couldn't monitor the chat while I was presenting. You probably had let me know earlier. So those benefits that I just described have been degraded and are under current stress due to historic and ongoing changes, including altered hydrology and widespread conversion of forests to farmland and urban development. These changes impact stream fish and invertebrate communities and lead to several impacts in the bay, including HABs and muck that washes up on the shore, siltation of spawning reefs, and others. These impacts are mediated by invasive mussels, which has further implications to the Lake Huron offshore. The Saginaw River and Bay are designated as an area of concern due to impairment of several beneficial uses, and progress towards delisting those impairments is ongoing. Just this year, harmful algal blooms were a primary incentive for the Michigan Department of Environment, Great Lakes, and Energy to designate the inner portion of Saginaw Bay as impaired. And so the state has initiated the development of a TMDL, which will be a multi-year process to address those issues. So what are we and our partners doing to address these issues? Well, the Nature Conservancy has been working in this geography for over a decade to incentivize and increase adoption of best management practices, including cover crops and conservation tillage, as well as a few newer projects I'll describe in a moment. And there is a link that will be in this presentation as I share that with Connor for you to follow up on with more information. And specifically, our goal is for the implementation of these best management practices on half of the farmland acres in the watershed. And of course, we're just one among several entities contributing to achieving this goal. NRCS, conservation districts, and many others also prioritize actions in the watershed. To date, the Nature Conservancy has directly influenced actions on over 150 farms, leading to more than 86,000 acres of BMPs implemented and prevention of almost 7,000 tons of sediment and almost 27,000 pounds of phosphorus runoff. And we recognize we still have a long way to go and are constantly seeking to learn and improve. So briefly, and I'd have to give credit to our team, Ben Wickerham, Becky McNitt, and Joel Leland, who do all this work. I'm gonna touch on some of our initiatives, and you may or may not know that sugar beets are a major crop in the watershed, and traditional tillage of sugar beets is quite intensive and leads to a lot of nutrient and sediment export. There is new specialized tillage equipment, strip tillers, that can substantially reduce the amount of ground that is disturbed, but the equipment is quite expensive. And so through this asset project, we're going to provide funding to overcome that financial barrier, as well as technical support. And we hope to demonstrate success with at least 10 farmers in the next 5 years as a demonstration. So in our sustainable wheat project with Star of the West, we are striving to improve resilience, soil health, and biodiversity in wheat fields throughout the watershed. The program requires farmers to meet 7 criteria, and in year one, we have enrolled 934 acres, accounting for 86,000 bushels of sustainably grown wheat. That's just the first year. In partnership with then Michigan Milk Producers Association, we're also offering incentives to implement new feed management strategies and crop production practices to reduce dairy cattle methane emissions and support soil health. And so this is a new project that we're implementing across North America. So far, we have 4 farms enrolled, comprising over 200 acres with 800 head of dairy cattle treated, amounting to almost $30,000 in sustainable practices. And our goal is to enroll 30 farms over the next 3 years. We also know that farmers are often the most trusted source of information for other farmers. And so we have set a goal to establish at least 3 farmer-led watershed groups in the Saginaw River watershed for the purpose of adopting more nutrient management practices to reduce those phosphorus loads to the Saginaw River and Bay. And we have met that goal for establishing those groups, though we're not clear yet how that has contributed to practice adoption. And so we're going to be following up on that over the next couple of years as well. And lastly, and I'm gonna spend a lot of my time on this, over the past several years, we've been co-managing a collaborative effort to establish comprehensive and sustained monitoring of water quality in Saginaw Bay and its watershed through the Saginaw Bay Monitoring Consortium. And here you can see our primary partners in the Saginaw Bay Monitoring Consortium. We've been working together since 2017, really, is when we began planning this out to address a long recognized dearth of data on water quality for the Bay and its watershed. So we're seeking to answer several key questions, including what is the condition of the Bay and its tributary streams? Has progress been made toward restoration? Has the interim phosphorus loading target that was established in the 2012 Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement, has that been met? And is it appropriate even for this Bay. What is the status of the AOC's eutrophication BUI, and what are some appropriate restoration criteria for that BUI? From our perspective, TNC, we recognize that tens of millions of dollars have been invested in watershed interventions intended to reduce non-point and point source pollutants, including our own efforts lasting over a decade. And yet there is little to no assurance that these efforts are paying off in a meaningful way. So we need additional data. This slide kind of represents the case of data that's been collected through in the watershed in the Bay over the past several decades. And it's not that nothing has been happening. It's just that most of those efforts have been short-term, inconsistently located, and following different protocols. So we want to establish more consistent protocols over the long-term in strategic locations, both in the Bay and in the watershed. The map here shows the relatively few locations that have more than 5 years of data, which stands in stark contrast to, you know, for example, Western Lake Erie, where Heidelberg University has been monitoring tributary sites for decades through the National Center for Water Quality Research. And so after several years, our team now has funding from EPA, thank you very much, to expand the bay monitoring to include new sites in the outer bay while continuing to monitor those inner bay sites. You can see on this map here in the green, sites that have been monitored since about 2014, and these will be the new ones in yellow. We're going to be establishing 18 tributary monitoring sites consisting of ISCO auto samplers paired with pre-existing and several new USGS gauges. Saginaw Valley State University will manage the auto samplers and laboratory analyses, while obviously USGS will be managing those gauges. And our objectives for this tributary monitoring in terms of site selection were to capture the major sub-watersheds of the Saginaw River, which is most of this watershed. You can see here the relatively few coastal watersheds. Everything else drains through the Saginaw River. And also representing those smaller coastal tribs that have substantial ag land, all to clarify sources of nutrients and sediments. And as we calculate loadings and then couple the data from tributaries in the bay through modeling, inform how those sources affect the bay. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on our site selection criteria, but I can take questions on that later. These are the parameters that we have identified with multiple partners, both within the streams and in the bay. And we are focusing both on stressor parameters and response parameters to understand those relationships. I do want to talk just a little bit about what has been ongoing and what will continue in the Bay. So NOAA, through the Great Lakes Environmental Research Lab, has historical data back to 1991. There's been pretty consistent monitoring in 4 to 5 inner Bay sites at approximately biweekly intervals through the open water system. There are also a couple of buoys in the bay that are transmitting real-time sensor-based data in addition to those 5 sites that are sampled biweekly. So their recent funding through GLRI will support enhanced monitoring and a second buoy in the outer bay. So this map is from their website. Link is up here where you can actually get data from those sites for the period that those sites are actively sampled. This is the latest data that I could find for the site SB1 in the inner bay. And this is all managed again on these two websites. There's historic data available through this website here. So how are we going to be using the data? Well, again, going back to those key questions, we're going to be assessing phosphorus loading relative to the current interim target and inform an update to that target, potentially. It will also inform actions within the AOC and to address Michigan's TMDL once that's finalized. And for TNC and others, working within the watershed to assess the effectiveness of past and ongoing actions. And finally, we're just beginning to scope the development of models that can help us understand stressor response curves and potentially the relationship of Saginaw Bay nutrient dynamics and trophic status to that of the main body of Lake Huron perhaps even downstream into the St. Clair to Detroit River system in Lake Erie. So that's, those discussions are just beginning. So there, we'll have an update on that perhaps in a year. And finally, we are developing a story map and dashboard to provide information. There are a broad suite of partners within the watershed that are all interested in water quality. So we're not the first to be considering these questions. And we hope to publish an early version within the next few months. This is just a snapshot of what it could look like incorporating data just from two active sites. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doug. That was a great, another great presentation. A reminder that if you have any questions, to put them in the chat, and that this webinar will be recorded and posted onto the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative webpage afterwards. Up next, we will be hearing from Ruth Breland with an update on Lake Erie.
Great, thank you so much. Make sure I've got the right screen selected to share. Here we go. All right. So kind of moving, following the flow of water through the Great Lakes, I'll focus on Lake Erie. And there's quite a history of HABs in Lake Erie, and most of that work has focused on the recent blooms in the western portion of the basin of the lake that are dominated by microcystis. We know so much about what drives those blooms, primarily the nutrients, phosphorus, that we've heard about in earlier presentations. But in this case, it's from the Maumee watershed flushing through the Maumee River into the West Basin of Lake Erie. As I said, we've got a lot of research and programs that have been addressed and presented on in the past. And what I'm showing in the right-hand side here are a series of satellite images where we can actually monitor and document both the size and intensity of the bloom from satellites. And so much work has been done on the nutrient loading. Heidelberg was mentioned, I think, in the previous talk that where they quantify different nutrient concentrations, amounts, and then flow data from USGS, particularly during the springtime months and period, and calculate an overall load and even estimate or forecast how much of an intensity of bloom we expect in the following summer. We also have monitoring programs throughout the growing season for nutrients, the types of cyanobacteria, and even toxins that they may produce. And typically these microcystis blooms, since that taxa typically requires warmer water temperatures, it tends to be a little bit later into those summer months. But we've documented other types of blooms in Lake Erie, particularly the Dahlia spermum one, I think it was mentioned in an earlier talk, and it's shown in the middle picture here. It's popped up either co-occurrence with other blooms or in particular early July in the central basin, more of a transient short-lived bloom. And finally, in Sandusky Bay, which if I get my clicker going. Yes, we can highlight here the portion of the lake that the Sandusky Bay is in. They've had a persistent bloom of planktothrix, which typically prefers different water conditions, perhaps more turbid, shallower, lower light, and is more adapted to lower light. And Dr. George Bullerjean at Bowling Green State University, him and his students and lab have studied these blooms since around 2013. And the bulk of the work I'll present today are actually slides that he's contributed. I'm also highlighting the screenshot here is from the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative Research Mapper, where Dr. Bullerjean has noted this project and details about it, where you can download recent papers. And he also wrote an article in our fall newsletter. So I've added the QR codes here since the links can be a little bit long. And I certainly want to acknowledge the students, Michelle Nudek, a PhD student who is out doing a lot of the collections and generated much of the data I'll present in following slides. So in terms of transitioning of the community, they've observed in very recent years, just to set the stage for the sampling, the different sites in both the upper and lower bay are shown here. So they're sampling multiple locations and then one just outside of the bay into Lake Erie. The data we'll look at is primarily sequencing data of both cyanobacteria genes, the 16S, as well as chloroplasts. So those represent other types of algae or eukaryotic algae. And they have collected, of course, other water quality parameters using fluoroprobe that can quickly assess what the major groups based on phytopigments, water quality, nutrients, cyanotoxin data, but that's a bit beyond the scope of the talk today. So starting with 2018, and these are relative abundance in percentage, and they're basically stacked plots. So the yellow shown here in the very first sample, early June, is essentially 100% dominated by that Planktothrix. And pretty much it's the same story for almost all the sites across all the dates in 2018. So consistent with what they've seen historically. Adding on 2019, sorry for the delay, we start to see a period of transition where, yes, it starts off early July dominated by Planktothrix, but they move later into the season, warmer temperatures and things, other organisms, both eukaryotic, algae, as well as other types of cyanobacteria become present, more abundant, and even dominant. So it's kind of asking, is there a transition during this year? And moving forward in time to 2020, actually Planktothrix is still shown in yellow, but it's just a very minor component of the community shown at the very top. It's representing generally less than 1% or 2% of any given sample at any given time. And you see overall transition in colors throughout from June to later in the summer. And the ones that become most dominant are from the order Cynococcales, a different type of cyanobacteria that's shown in orange here and green. So potentially a completely different shift, one from entirely dominated by Planktothrix to one where they're just a minor, barely present part of the community at sites across all dates of the year. So looking more recently, from 2021 and 2022, they're still doing a lot of the data analysis and crunching. They expect to have the sequencing information in spring of 2023. But initially, that data from the flora probes show that green algae were more dominant, cyanobacteria were more of a minor component of the community. But they did have a surprise during June of this year, 2022, with some scums present. It was dominated by Phanazominon, with a minor component of Dolichospermum. And this is actually a picture from those samples under the microscope. So a Phanazominon is these individual filaments or trichomes, and they can clump together in little tufts and give this classic look during a bloom of grass clippings even. And you can almost see that in this picture here. They also are buoyant, float up to the top, and this bottle is kind of showing a representation of that scum and what they saw that year. So when they looked back at the metagenomic data sets from prior years, there was in fact a June appearance of a Phanazominon in 2020, but there was no surface scum documented as that they had in 2022. So they're seeing this transient appearance of potential nitrogen fixing cyanobacteria where they had not previously seen that in years when Planktothrix was dominant. So of course the question is, why are we seeing this drastic change in cyanobacteria? Well, it's unclear. Oh my goodness. Are you seeing my slide okay?
Yes, we are.
Okay, I'm sorry, on my screen it just looks like me and I accidentally saw it and was a little concerned. Okay, so the question about why there was that drastic change in Sandusky Bay. Well, it is unclear and an active research question that they hope to probe into more. But the initial observations, they do not expect it to be due to changes in nutrient levels because all spring dates had high nitrogen and phosphorus. So not, and they have looked historically, those Planktothrix blooms were not driven by changes or abundance of nutrients like the Western Basin bloom is. There is a note that they had higher water levels in some of the recent years, but it's not consistent since they've had some blooms in different years. And one, the 2020 year had fewer sediment resuspension events that would otherwise explain the regenerate nutrients that would occur in the summers, but that didn't occur in other years. So temporarily, they've actually linked it to an event that occurred late 2020 or 2018, which was the removal of the Ballville Dam. It's important to note this is speculation. They don't have the data to suggest was there a change in sediment loading or something with that removal, but some so correlation is not always causation, but something to probe at and look at as they move forward. So do you want to mention for anyone who's kind of new that the NOAA does produce, I wanted to highlight the summary for the Western Lake Erie harmful algal bloom. This year, it was a moderately severe bloom. So it's the last bar here. They documented it as 6.8 on the scale. started out pretty typical. They began mid-July. The peak was in late August. And so the satellite image here is actually showing the maximum concentration during that peak 30-day period. It persisted for several weeks, but there through mid-September. Then there were some elevated wind events that occurred that reduced the surface concentrations, but the bloom didn't really die off or terminate. Unlike previous years, the bloom actually transitioned from microcystis to dolichospermum later in the summer or later into the fall during early October. And again, they had high cyanobacteria concentrations that actually persisted through early November, which is a much longer bloom, later bloom than we've seen than usual. And while dolichospermum can produce different cyanotoxins, monitoring conducted by NOAA Glural measured only very low amounts of microcystin during that October bloom. And you can get a link directly to that summary through that QR code if you want to learn more. Finally, I would be remiss if I didn't touch on Ohio's efforts to address the blooms in Western Lake Erie. We are actively working on the Mommy Watershed Nutrient TMDL, or Total Maximum Daily Load, which is our restoration plan specifically addressing the phosphorus loading from both point and non-point sources that drive those microcystis blooms in Western Lake Erie. There are five steps to our Ohio's TMDL process, and we've actually completed through the fourth step with that preliminary modeling results. The final documents were recently posted on our project website. And we're actively developing the draft TMDL report with the goal of having it posted for public review by the end of this calendar year. And we have a webinar scheduled for December 22nd. I'm sorry, was scheduled for December 20th, 2022. So you can find out all the details, including past recorded webinars, different fact sheets, and all of those documents at our project website through this QR code here. And if you want to be notified directly of any upcoming events, future webinars, and when projects are posted, either for the Lake Erie or Mommy Watershed Nutrient TMDL or other TMDLs in our state, you can actually sign up for our listserv at this QR code. Since that TMDL is more of our planning document, I also want to mention our H2O Ohio program that's focused funds and efforts specifically to reduce agricultural phosphorus runoff and ultimately prevent the blooms. This initiative invests substantially to help our farmers reduce phosphorus runoff and from both commercial fertilizers and manure to help prevent the blooms. And it's after a lot of study, both scientific and economic studies, we've identified seven effective and cost-efficient practices that are shown to really to be very effective in reducing phosphorus. So we're providing economic incentives to implement those best management practices, starting with a voluntary nutrient management plan. And this originally focused only on the Maumee River watershed, but has now expanded to other areas in the state. It's important to mention there's other arms and focus programs under the H2 Ohio umbrella. So I encourage you to go to the website there, h2.ohio.gov, to learn more. And finally, I haven't talked much about the actual bloom. So if you want to learn more about our HAB bloom program in Ohio, you can go to ohioalgaeinfo.com. You can also report blooms if you see them to us within the state. And that concludes my slides. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Ruth. Thanks for stepping in and sharing that really interesting information with us. We're moving to our final presenter today, Tony Prestigiacomo, who will give us an update on Lake Ontario.
Hi, everyone. Thanks, Connor. Is my screen visible?
Yes, you look good.
Excellent. Thank you. Hi, everyone. As Connor said, I'm Tony with the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. I'm going to give you a kind of a broader overview of HABs monitoring and research in New York State, including DEC's monitoring programs and our reporting mechanism for HABs called MyHABs. Touch a little bit on some of the DEC's research, mitigation, and clean water planning efforts with regards to HABs, and then briefly talk about some upcoming work on Lake Ontario. So the primary mechanism by which harmful algal blooms are reported to New York State DEC are through the NIHABS system. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit. But basically, it's a system where professionals or the public can report harmful algal blooms on any lake to the DEC, and then they are integrated and reported online in an ArcGIS format. The DEC is involved with our own harmful algal bloom monitoring. A lot of our monitoring takes place in our core programmatic efforts through the rotating integrated basin studies cycle. The lake classification and inventory program monitors ponded waters, stream monitoring and assessment is flowing waters, and we have monitoring long-term trend monitoring networks in both lake and riverine systems. We also employ the efforts of dedicated citizen scientists through our CSLAP program, which is lake assessment program, and water stream macroinvertebrate assessments through our WAVE program. NIHABS, or New York Harmful Algal Bloom System, was developed by New York State to quickly and easily receive harmful algal bloom reports. Lake Ontario, knock on wood, I don't want to jinx it, doesn't receive a lot of HABs reports in the lake proper. Some of the embayments certainly do. But you can see from the map, which was a screenshot of the NIHAB system before it was shut down for 2022, that we get a lot of HABs reports in New York State on a wide range of water bodies. Small water bodies, eutrophic water bodies, large lakes like some of the Finger Lakes, oligotrophic lakes have HABs in New York. And so the volume of reports coming in was becoming very insurmountable for the staff to manage and report on in an efficient way. So NIHABs was built by the HABs program coordinator in the Lake Management Assessment section, Dr. Rebecca Gorney. And this is what NIHABs looks like on the user interface. And so essentially, reports, survey 123 reports come in, they get integrated into the system, and then the results are displayed on a user-friendly map. I'm going to click. I've highlighted some of the HABs reports from Lake Ontario, nearshore, and embayment areas in 2022. And one of the really neat features about the ArcGIS online tools is that it's interactive. You can click on the points. You can learn if the report or if the HABs report is active or if it's archived. Of course, this is a screenshot, but you know, as per all the ArcGIS line tools, you can grab the data associated with these. You can click on the links and get photos. These are publicly available and available to the professionals here at the DEC as we screen through and filter the confirmed HAB reports versus the ones that are false flags. All of the harmful algal bloom information that comes into New York State is archived in our database, our website, and I'll have a link, a slide with all of our links to our HABs websites later on. But all of it's available in various formats, PDF archives, or you can download the data itself. Of interest might be this long-term summary of water bodies that have had reported HABs since 2012. I've clicked on Monroe County, which is the county that which Rochester is in, which is a big city right near Lake Ontario. And anyone can click on these and see the extent of the blooms on various water bodies in New York. Now for some research, and I'm gonna give you a little bit of a brief overview on this project. I wanna make sure that I mention that there are lots of other research efforts going on in New York by the USGS, by NOAA, by private and academic researchers. This project was kind of a partnership project with the DEC and United States Geological Survey, where we looked to try to find causes of HABs in New York State lakes, a handful. We used, the objectives were to document HABs in the study lakes, investigate the use of various sensors to monitor and measure for chlorophyll and cyanobacteria, microcystin, and develop a friendly, data-friendly user interface for folks to access the data for their own purposes as well. There were four basic strategies for this project. One was monitoring water quality in the tributaries to these lakes. Two, the use of high-frequency automated monitoring platforms in the lakes, which the data is available on the USGS NWIS website. Three, looking at a few lakes on a very intensive spatial, analysis. And four, shoreline mapping of a lot of measurements around the shoreline of each of those study lakes. And so those efforts were conducted in the field from 2019 to 2020. The field portion is wrapped up. As you can imagine, it's a lot of data that is coming in. The data products are available online at the USGS website. And we're starting, which is very exciting, to get some of the expected outputs published, which is really nice. This one highlighted Leglider et al. 2022 was kind of an offshoot, but they used some of the advanced monitoring data from Owasco Lake in New York to look at a novel approach at remote sensing for harmful algal bloom impacts. And so above and beyond the kind of core outputs from the main components, it's pretty exciting that a lot of the data can be used by other folks to do lots of other analyses. A little plug for some New York State DEC HABs research. We're looking at many facets of causes of HABs and HABs in New York State. Five are listed on the screen here. We're looking at decadal-long trends in HAB reporting across the statewide harmful algal bloom indicators in stream and riverine systems, remote sensing tools for chlorophyll A, spatial representativeness on an intensive study in a very low nutrient lake in New York State, Skinny Atlas Lake, which is the sole water supply for the city of Syracuse. And we're looking at intensive looks at cyanobacteria and other oligotrophic lakes as well. This is just a photo collage to give me a break and some of the neat visuals that are coming out of the analysis and the products resolving in the upper left, kind of the timeline of how HABs are forming and developing in big lakes. The lower left, decadal trends and HAB reporting across New York State. Middle bottom is an application of a remote sensing tool to look at chlorophyll distribution in the large area of the Finger Lakes. The map of New York State is distributions of cyanobacteria and microcystin indicators in flowing water systems. And the lower right, looking at community composition differences in time, space, and depth in Skinny Atlas Lake, New York. And of course, the monitoring and research are part of it, but we're also looking at ways to mitigate in water body HABs through lake management directives. We're looking at things like nutrient inactivants, hydrogen peroxide, testing the efficacy of ultrasonic treatments, algae harvesters, and et cetera, to see in impacted lakes, do we have the tools necessary to reduce the extent and duration of HABs? And that website link clicks to the DEC HABs mitigation website that you can go to and see more. And of course, as others have mentioned, you know, when we talk about HABs, we still talk about the primary strategy is to reduce nutrient inputs and you know, lower phosphorus levels primarily. So the DEC has a bureau dedicated towards clean water planning. We do, some lakes have harmful algal bloom plans specifically. But in the toolkit are also total maximum daily load analyses and nine elements planning to help reduce the flow of nutrients and reduce the impact of HABs. And now for a quick update on Lake Ontario. So in 2023 is the field year for Lake Ontario CSMI, and we're working with the USGS to replicate their LON study, which is Lake Ontario Nearshore Nutrient Survey. You can see the map of Lake Ontario. The blue circles represent the study locations from previous LONS investigations the USGS did. And it ranges from Buffalo down here in the lower left-hand corner through Rochester all the way up to the St. Lawrence. More than 30 sites investigated for nutrients, chlorophyll, clarity. We were able to add some contaminants of emerging concern, some organics, mercury, and this year we're adding a lot of cyanobacteria indicators, cell counts, cyanotoxins, and general HABs observations as well. And all of these data are available at the USGS website on the previous LONS efforts. And finally, in 2023, the USGS is going to be conducting a study of a few embayments on Lake Ontario, where they're going to deploy continuous water quality monitoring platforms that will collect data in very high frequency and provide it in real time to get a better understanding of ecosystem total production, respiration, and extent of HABs in those embayments. And those data will be available on the normal CSMI cycle. But again, the field collection for that is next year. This slide, and I can paste these in the chat too, are some of the HABs resources available by the New York State DEC, including the website, our program guide, the research guide and then the various monitoring portals where the data from our core and citizen volunteer efforts are available to the public to investigate and download. And that's it. That was a very brief overview. I thank you for your time. If anyone has any questions or comments, feel free to reach out. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Before we move into the Q&A, I wanted to share one additional piece from the HABs Collaborative, but also a big thank you to all of our speakers. It was really great presentations from everybody today. From the HABs Collaborative, I did want to speak on an additional project which was mentioned, the HABs Research Mapper. The HABs Research Mapper is an app to share regional research projects to increase collaboration among researchers and water managers working to investigate and address HABs in the Great Lakes Basin. We ask you to please consider adding your own research projects to the mapper. You can find out more at the link above, which I will also be dropping into the chat. At the link, there's also some more information about how to join the HABs Collaborative listserv. The listserv is a moderated email group with opportunities to find out more about our future HABs-related events, webinars, and to receive the HABs Collaborative's periodic newsletter. With that, we will now move into our Q&A. I will, in just a moment, spotlight some of our speakers. However, I will start with a question to Tony. Does New York do source water, does source reduction or BMPs to reduce HABs?
Great question. We do, most of our source reduction is targeting nutrient reductions in the watersheds and or and we're doing some pilot studies to reduce nutrients in the lakes themselves. But a lot of our clean water planning and TMDLs are still the kind of traditional reduce phosphorus type objectives.
Thank you for that. And there was an additional question. It looks like you have a lot of data on microcystin in flowing waters in New York. Is microcystin sampled as part of DEC's routine stream monitoring?
The flowing waters was a 5-year study and that's kind of wrapped up. We do collect microcystin at times through our other monitoring programs. One thing I could have mentioned in the NIHABs slide is a lot of our HABs reporting comes through on the visual evaluation from the volunteers and people submitting a report, which are then evaluated by DEC professionals to confirm a bloom. Sometimes those are associated with flora probe or other algal quantification samples or microcystin, but not all the time. Usually it's the visual confirmation that constitutes a bloom in NIHABs.
Thank you for that. This one is open to any of our presenters. How has the observed changing weather patterns impacted the development of HABs across all of the Great Lakes?
You're on mute, Gina.
Uh-oh, it looks like you're still having some technical difficulties. Maybe you could figure that out and when we'll come back to you if someone else wants to start answering that question.
I can speak to the observations of HABs in Green Bay. I think for with regards to weather, what we are seeing is a change in the timing of the harmful alga bloom events. We're seeing an increased growing season. And so from that regard, we're seeing the blooms definitely last well past what we would consider the recreational season, kind of that Memorial Day to Labor Day. We're also measuring cyanotoxins at very high levels past the recreational, the standard recreational season. So into October, we're actually measuring some of our highest cyanotoxin concentrations.
Thank you, Gina. Were you able to fix any of their audio issues, or was anyone else wanted to answer that question?
I guess for Lake Erie, I'll add that, you know, we do have a strong relationship between the weather events, the precipitation that occurs during the spring, which ultimately drives nutrients that ultimately relate to the bloom. But certainly, as the bloom has developed, it's local, like, wind and mixing patterns that affect, like, if you see scums and kind of where the bloom moves. So I would say, like, NOAA's products also incorporate a hydrological model to help predict how that they'll detect the current status of the bloom from satellite imagery and then detect where it'll move. But certainly the unique features, like we were seeing that transition and shift late this year, leave questions open to what are the drivers of those changes, and maybe they could be related to weather and climate events.
Thank you. It looks like Gina is having some audio issues, but was able to answer in the chat. She says, in Lake Superior, the largest blooms have occurred in years with the warmest lake water temperatures, and they have followed 500 to 1,000 year storm events. There was also an earlier question about dissolved reactive phosphorus and whether that is a problem in other Great Lakes, or is that is more of a Lake Erie specific focus, if someone has any thoughts on that.
So in Green Bay, we do measure soluble reactive phosphorus. I would say though that we also have total maximum daily loads, and they're set on total phosphorus. So there is a little bit of research going on trying to look at, kind of tease out some of the drivers for the blooms and the toxins. However, I would say, like, on a larger scale, just given the current guidelines and water quality standards, the focus does tend to be on total phosphorus, just when you're kind of talking about a lot of these overarching questions. There definitely needs to be a little bit more work kind of teasing out some of these more specifics. However, I will just say that, you know, there is never enough money to answer all of these questions. And I saw there was another question asking if there was any molecular work, and I will just go ahead and right away answer that a lot of the monitoring that is going on right now, looking at HABs in Green Bay, this work is, you know, kind of cobbled together. There is never enough money to do monitoring in general, never enough money to do the cyanotoxin monitoring, let alone the molecular work that is desperately needed. So just something to keep in mind that there are some researchers who are definitely interested in this work, and some people are donating their time in kind. And it is an area that there are quite a few people that are interested in, but we just don't really have the resources right now. Not to be doom and gloom, I'm sorry, but there's a lot of interest. So just something to keep in mind.
Thank you, Sarah. Yes, you were picking up on, there was a question of, is anyone aware of core sample studies on the Great Lakes other than Lake Superior, which are looking for DNA evidence of HABs events over previous decades or centuries? If anyone else wanted to tackle that question. An additional question for all of our presenters. Does anyone know any research projects that are interested in the health issues which are created by HABs and cyanobacteria? And I will give a plug that there are some fact sheets available on the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative website, which I have shared a link to, which covers some of those health issues. But if there was any presenters that wanted to speak on any research that they know that's happening around that.
Yeah, I can touch from Ohio. Our Ohio's Department of Higher Education has supported research funds through the Harmful Algal Bloom Research Initiative, or HABRI grants. Many of those in recent years have focused on health-based effects. Sorry, I think someone else is... Okay, muted. I can add the link to the general project summary there, but researchers at University of Toledo, Drs. Kennedy and Haller, who actually led some of the initial work on those fact sheets that through the HABs Collaborative have been funded through these HABRE grants. So those would be, and I know that they were also working on a special issue of a research publication pulling together recent work on the health impacts of blooms. Thanks.
Thank you, Ruth. A different question has come up. Is anyone aware of tracking changes in phosphorus from Lake Erie into Lake Ontario, or similarly, I guess, between any two of the Great Lakes?
That's an ongoing question. This is Tony from the New York State DEC. That's an ongoing issue. The connective channels between Erie and Ontario, and there continue to be planned studies to better evaluate nutrient loading from Lake Ontario to Lake Ontario. I think the USGS is the primary entity involved with those studies.
Thank you for that. This has been somewhat addressed, but I wanted to just raise up this question. Are any HABs monitoring and response programs, including molecular tools like quantitative or digital PCR to detect HAB species and toxin genes?
One thing I could add here, in Ohio, our drinking water systems that pull from Lake Erie as well as other surface waters in Ohio actually use the phytoxygen qPCR kit to identify genes associated with production of different cyanotoxins. And so they can test for the genes associated with microcystins, saxitoxins, and Salinger's pyrimopsin. So that's actually part of our rules for them to collect those samples. And then we do additional testing directly for the cyanotoxins. They are testing, I should say that they're also testing for microcystins as well as part of their proactive monitoring program.
Thank you. Gina, I wanted to add, I believe Indiana DEM uses phytotoxigen in their monitoring program. We have one more question. Most phytoplankton require more nitrogen than phosphorus to grow, yet everyone seems to focus on phosphorus reduction. Are there measured phosphorus concentrations, total phosphorus, or is it only phosphorus that is in a form usable by phytoplankton?
So I'll add here in Ohio, particularly the Maumee River and other tributaries into the western basin of Lake Erie. The Heidelberg data set, they are monitoring total phosphorus as well as that dissolved reactive phosphorus. They also calculate a bioavailable portion. So we do have a lot of information about that loading, but sometimes it's easier to or more appropriate to develop targets associated with total versus just one particular component of the phosphorus. So it kind of depends, I think, on your angle if we're developing a target or a program to reduce phosphorus efforts, but ones that help address the labile or bioavailable portion are very important.
Yeah, and the reason we tend to focus on phosphorus instead of nitrogen is that phosphorus is usually the limiting nutrient in aquatic primary production. The algae do require a lot more nitrogen, but phosphorus generally limits in freshwater systems, hence the focus on it as a control.
Thank you both. I will say there are lots of great links and resources and articles being shared in the chats. I will do my best to kind of collect some of those as well as some resources from our speakers and follow up with those who are registered for today's webinar. I also want to remind everyone that this webinar is being recorded and that will be posted to the Great Lakes HAB Collaborative website, which I will again share in a follow up. And I just wanted to say a huge thank you to all of our speakers and also to all of you for participating in today's webinar. I do want to say that we're going to wrap up just a few minutes early here and give you a few minutes here at the end of your day. Thank you again so much for being with the Great Lakes HABs Collaborative and being able to hear about all the great work being done and highlighted by our speakers. Thank you so much.